Senator Brown, we're thankful that put those rocks together in a little jar and testimony of God's goodness, lest we forget that He is good. Turn your Bibles to Psalm 100. You know the psalm. If you grew up in church or were ever involved in scripture memory at all, this was one of the psalms you memorized. It's 5 verses long. Very easy. We could probably all of us say it in the King James from memory. I'm going to read it, though, from the English Standard Version and just ask you to follow along with your Bible. If you don't have a Bible with you, we really want to get you one in your hands. But we put the text on the screen so that, that you may be able to see for yourselves what the Scripture says. I never want you to take for granted anything that was said. But test everything by the Scriptures. Be Bereans. Really to search the Scriptures to see if what is asserted is so in the Word. So if you stand with me as we read, we follow along as I read Psalm 100, by the way, as a result of what the doctor found or did not find in the ankle, he's downgraded me to an ankle brace and a boot. He's released me to drive. And I drove this morning for the first time. And I'm so grateful to see Jim Schrott here because, you see, I'm traveling in his wake. He's getting knee surgeries before me, and I'm following right behind him, so I see him up and around it. And the encouragement that is to me. Follow along as I read. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come into His presence with singing. Know that the Lord, He is God. It is He who made us, and we are His. We are His people, and the sheep of His pasture. Enter into His gates with thanksgiving, and His courts with praise. Give thanks to Him. Bless His name. For the Lord is good. His steadfast love endures forever, and His faithfulness to all generations. We just read what the inerrant, infallible, all-sufficient Word of God. And oh, that this song would wash over us again and again. We would worship corporately, privately, in small family settings. We would worship with thankful hearts, considering who God is, what He's like, what He has done, what our response is to be to that. Thank you. Please be seated. Thursday was Thanksgiving Day. Friday was Black Friday. Even starting a little early for some, Thursday evening took on the appearance of Black Friday. It's called Black Friday because it is the day of great profit, by and large. But I really think the blackness of Friday is beginning to take on an increasingly different meaning. I don't know if you saw any of the videos that are available on Facebook of some of the shopping experiences on Black Friday for some people. But it's interesting to me that as I watch some of these, one particular that stuck in my mind, where I forget the store, but there was a stack of vegetable steamers. Vegetable steamers. It must have been a really good steamer. It must have been a really good deal. Because the video from Phone's Phone shows a group of people who look to be adult size descending upon this stack, knocking it over so that vegetable steamers were scattering everywhere. Some with two, one in each arm. And one particular scene was a child had one. There's a lot of questions about that. Why would you take a child into that setting for crying out loud? And then an adult who had two managed to hold on to the two and snatch the one from the child. And I watched that and I thought, I wonder what Thanksgiving she looks like on these people. I find it hard to believe that at Thanksgiving lunch they had all the ads spread out. They were putting on more paint, getting ready to go do battle in the world of the consumer. I would think that for some of these people that were sitting around eating, reflecting, being thankful, maybe some of it not even to do with God, what God has given, but just a sense of thankfulness. And to go from gratitude to greed so quickly. And I thought how fickle we can be. And the way that you battle fickleness in people is you help yourself and help one another get focused on the things that matter. This psalm, in my mind, is a focusing psalm. It calls upon us to think about what matters. In fact, it calls us to do four things and to know two things. And to the extent that we apply ourselves to these admonitions in this psalm, these calls that come to us, we will be increasingly a joyful, glad, thankful people who know that we are the precious possession of the Creator, who not only made us, but made us His because of His faithfulness to His covenant mercies. I want us to look just a few minutes today at six considerations out of these five verses. First of all, a call to make a joyful noise. Then second, a call to serve the Lord with gladness. Third, a call to come into the Lord's presence with singing. Those are some of your do's He's calling us to do. And fourth, a call to know who God is. Fifth, a call to enter God's house with thanksgiving and praise. And sixth, a call to know the character of God. The character of God. Let's look at these just briefly together. First of all, a call to make a joyful noise. Verse 1 simply says, make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Now, we tend, when we read that, and I've said this before, I've heard other people say it, look, there is an admonition to sing, because the Lord does not say to us, sing if you know how to carry a tune. Sing if you can sing one of the four parts, if you can sing soprano or alto or tenor or bass. Sing if it's pleasant to the ear. There's none of that in the scriptures. And some people say if you can make a joyful noise, then you're qualified to sing. And certainly singing is involved in that. I think that's true. But you know, there's more than one way to make a joyful noise. I think giggling is a joyful noise. Doesn't it do something to your spirit when a little child giggles? When they just get tickled? I maintain, and Karen, there have been times when our children, and even now our grandchildren, will do something or say something that could provoke a disdain and a desire to discipline. But when sometimes they come out of the mouth of a child with a little giggling grin, and you just can't, you have to just turn away. It does something to you. The joyful noise of laughter, the joyful noise of cheering. Well, there's something very moving about the different ways we can make noise that provokes joy. You know, I watched my team lose again last night. I told you I'm a Texas Aggie fan because it's the best thing for my sanctification. It just continually keeps me humble and exposes remaining sin. And watching that whole game where the coach of LSU was supposedly going to be fired, and you saw the admiration shown for him by the fans, and just, oh, it was very moving. And it brought joy to see people express that kind of love and devotion and appreciation. We're called to make a joyful noise to the Lord. In fact, it's universal. All the earth. There's no one excluded from this. What do you have to do to be qualified to make a joyful noise? You need to have the capacity to inhale and exhale. I will submit to you, however, that when you look around at the earth, at the people who dwell in the earth, one of the things you do not see an overabundance of is joy. You see sadness. You see discontentment. You see a mentality, a you owe me mentality that's now grown into monstrous proportions. But to be honest with you, when I read the people who are supposed to be young adults, they're old enough to go to college. When they want people arrested for saying things that hurt their feelings, when they want safe zones on college campuses, that is so immature. And by the way, if you watch it, they're not happy about anything they get. Getting it only stirs up, it seems like more of a discontentment. What we need is we need an infusion of joy and joyfulness in our culture. It's too easy to grumble and complain, and I'm telling you, chief of sinners here, rather than find a place to rejoice. Earlier this week, this past week, dealing with something and thinking out loud and caring to give thanks in all circumstances. She just heard a sermon on Sunday by a preacher. It occurred to me. We need joy. We're admonished to that, to make a joyful noise. We need to learn to laugh. We need to learn to giggle more. We need to set one another free to recognize the fingerprint of God. And you know, if things are going terribly around you, be able to move through that, look through that, and laugh. The Proverbs 31 comes to mind. We're told she laughs at the future. No, she's not mocking it. She knows what's ahead. And she's able to laugh. We talked last week about one of the things we need to remember is not only the past mercies of God, not only the present reality of the promises of God, but also the future expressions of the grace of God that are going to come to us. Ultimately being the return of our Savior, our King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and His taking us to be with Him forever and ever in a land where there is nothing but joy. We need to learn that. So, a call to make a joyful noise to all the earth is to do this. So, if all the earth is to do this, then certainly the people of God should lead the way, shouldn't we? Now, I pray for myself and for you that people will know us, will mark us out as people of joy. As this culture continues to go down the tubes, as it continues to get darker and darker, as things that we thought once were nailed down so that they couldn't be shaken loose, as they're being shaken loose, that people would know us as people of joy. Secondly, there's this call to serve the Lord with gladness. We know where to serve. In fact, we've woven together in our purpose statement that we are people. We believe we exist to follow Christ. We're Christ followers. The word Christian takes on a whole lot of different meanings. We're Christ followers. We've embraced and committed together that we're to love God, the chief commandment, love the Lord your God with all that you are and all that you have. We're to love God. We're to love others. Jesus said the second is likened to it. Love your neighbor as you love yourself. We're followers of Christ who love God, who love others. And we express that in serving the world. We've committed to that. We say that in many different ways, many different times, lest we ever forget. But our service should never be seen as drudgery. Serve the Lord, which is why we serve the world, by the way. As much as you've done it unto one of the least of these, my brethren, you've done it unto me, Jesus said. serve our God with gladness. If we're going to be a people who are known for making joyful noise, who giggle, who laugh, who cheer, who chuckle, who rejoice, then that should spill over into our acts of service. And here's what we do. You don't always feel like serving. I understand that. I get that. Sometimes the call to serve, the opportunity to serve, comes at what seems to be a very inopportune time. And again, it's easy to grumble. Serve the Lord. Commit as His servants. Following Jesus Christ, who didn't come to be served, but came to serve and to give His life a ransom, Mark says in Mark 10:45, that we too, taking on the character of Christ, being conformed to the image of Christ, that we too are called to serve. And we will serve with gladness. Maybe not always going in. It'd be wonderful, wouldn't it, if we approached every opportunity of service with gladness. Oh boy, if we giggled, if we chuckled, it came to us. But certainly when we get into it, this is the wonderful thing about serving the Lord. You may not enter the opportunity to serve with gladness, but you will always come out with it. Times, each of us can talk about times when we went visiting. We went knocking on doors. We didn't want to do it necessarily. We get gut level honest and say we knocked and prayed, oh Lord, I hope nobody answers. And then the door opens. And we engage. And we come away from those evenings every time, like realizing that the prophet you come to us, how we are richer. You're always richer when you serve. When you give away that which you cannot keep and should not keep. When you bless because you've been blessed and you know that you're blessed to be a blessing. You're called upon to serve the Lord, to touch others. And I could spend the rest of our time here this morning just identifying ways that so many of you do this. Some of it goes essentially unseen. There are things that I know about that I see. Nobody else can know about it. There are some things that only the Lord knows. You see, that's enough, isn't it? The Lord knows. It's one of the great things Jesus says in the letters to the seven churches, I know your works. And for those who are serving the Lord with gladness, that washes over us with such an encouragement and know your works. So we're called to serve. Third, we're called to come into the Lord's presence with singing, the second part of verse 2. Come into His presence with singing. Now, it is true that we live in the presence of God. We said last week, we ought to live mindful that we're living under the shadow of the cross of the Lord Jesus Christ. Come into His presence. We're singing. We live in His presence. But we're called to consciously come into His presence. Sometimes we're living in His presence and we forget that we're living in His presence. Life gets our attention. We get distracted. We're not doing what we're doing. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in His wonderful face. And the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory. We're not doing that. We're looking for things where we forget we're living in the presence of God. We're called to intentionally, consciously come into His presence. That is, take time, which you did today, to worship the Lord in corporate worship. There are different levels of intimacy with God in worship, private worship. And you should be mixed in that singing. Something about singing that expresses the heart. Martin Luther in the Reformation said, let the Pope's men write the theologies. I'll write the hymns. He knew the power of music. asked my brother this, and I agree wholeheartedly. They said, well, at your church, is your worship contemporary or traditional? He said to them, yes. It's contemporary because we do it every Sunday. It's traditional because we've been doing it for several decades. Yes. I like that. Coming to his presence with singing. Paul said in Ephesians 5, verse 19, that the one we have, the marks have been filled with the Spirit. In verse 19, addressing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody to the Lord in your heart. And for some, that may be as far as what it gets, is a singing, melodious sonnets in your heart. It may not make it out of them, out through the mouth. I think sadly, some people have been harmed growing up when they've been told by someone, you can't sing, you can't carry a note, etc., etc., etc. And they have been harmed by that. And they're hesitant to sing aloud. But if you could put some sort of device to their heart, you would hear the song. Come into his presence with singing. There's something about singing that can lift the downtrodden. Something about singing can express the heart to God in a way that, in ways that, that if we were not singing, we might find difficult to do. I have no doubt in my mind that some of the things we sang today, you connected with. There's within my heart a melody. Jesus whispers sweet and low. Fear not, I am with you. Peace be still in all, or whatever, wherever you are in life, whether it's ebb or flow. Jesus keeps me singing. So we're called to come into his presence with singing. We're also fourth called to know. This is the first call to know something, to know who God is. This is so wonderful. And if you memorize this song in the King James, you memorize it this way. Know that the Lord, he is God. It is he that has made us and not we ourselves. The ESV has a very accurate rendering of this. Because it is true that we're not to think of ourselves as self-made. But the reason we're not to think of ourselves as self-made is that we don't belong to ourselves. We're his. Look at this. Know that the Lord, he is God. It is he who made us and we are his. We're his people, the sheep of his pasture. Now, it's interesting to know, for you to know what's going on here. The Lord is the Hebrew word Yahweh. It is the name of God that's taken from that Hebrew verb, hayah, the verb to be. So that say, when Moses said, who shall I tell the Pharaoh has sent me? He's to tell him, Yahweh, the I am. Because in the Hebrew, the word hayah can mean was, I was, I am, I am, or shall be. It has that movement in it. Know that Yahweh, the covenant name for God, it comes over into English for us as Jehovah. Know that Yahweh, he is God. The word for God here is the word Elohim. Know that Yahweh is Elohim. Elohim is the term associated with God which identifies him as creator, as making everything that is. Yahweh, the covenant God, is the creator. It is he who made us. You know, let some people think that they are the product of some hairy ancestors who crawled out of primordial soup, if that makes them feel better, but same God who made Adam and took a rib and made Eve, the Ish, the man, and Isha, the woman, that this God formed me in the womb of my mother. It is He who made me. It is He who made you. I am not my own. I'm a creature. I'm a created being, made in the image of God, distinguished from all the other living creatures of the earth because I have a soul that will never die. I have that property in me that is eternal. He has put eternity in our hearts, our sense of knowing that there's more than this on this earth, the capacity to communicate with Him, our Creator. We are His. You see, as Yahweh Elohim, He is the God who not only made us Elohim, but made us His people, Yahweh, and relates to us as the shepherd of His sheep. He owns us. He cares for us. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not lack anything that I need. He leads me beside still water. He restores my soul. He leads me in the wagon tracks of His righteous paths. He anoints my head with oil, not in drops or droplets, so that my cup runs over. He prepares sustenance and provision for me in the very presence of those who would call themselves my enemies. And whatever I'm not sure of and don't know about, we have brethren in our congregation right now who are in situations that they don't know. They have more questions than they have answers to the providences they're facing. And however cloudy it might be, we can be sure of this, that surely His goodness and His mercy will follow us all the days of our lives. And that when life is over for us, sooner or later, that by His grace and for His glory, because of His provision for us in Jesus Christ, we will, by grace through faith, dwell in the house of the Lord forever and ever. Elohim, our Creator, is Yahweh, our Redeemer. We need to know that. If we don't know that, there's going to be a lot of things in life that will knock us off our promise. But if we know that, we come through. We come through. There's also this call to enter God's house with thanksgiving and praise. Verse 4, these images of gates and courts. It's a picture of the house of God, the place designated for the worship of God by the people of God in the days of the Jews. They were allowed into the inner place, the holy place. There were the outer courts where proselyte Gentiles could come. Jesus tore down the veil, ripped it from top to bottom, and in His blood shed on the cross. And so now there's access that all may draw near to the Lord, boldly to His throne by the grace of God shown to us as we have faith in Jesus Christ, His provision for the remedy for our sin. We're told to enter His gates, come into this place with thanksgiving. I hope you did that this morning. We need to train ourselves to do that. We need to remind one another to do that. Grateful when you have a helper suitable to your needs who will remind you, give thanks in all circumstances, Bill. Heed the words of the preacher. Grateful when we do that to one another. Thanksgiving. Roman reminded me, we were talking this morning about an advertisement. It calls this season of the year Thanksgiving. 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 because we know the giver, the true and living God, who so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. Jesus came, and he gave himself a ransom for sinners. And the Father and the Son together gave the Holy Spirit to come, regenerate, dwell in the midst of his people, in the hearts of his, of those made new by the gospel. We know the giver, the triune giving God. We have much for which to give thanks when we stop and count our blessings, and into his courts with praise. You see, you thank God for what he has given. You praise God for who he is. And they ought to be found together. Let us never fall victim of being thankful only when we get what we think we need, what we want, what we think we deserve. Let it be mixed with praise because of who God is, his character, which brings us to think about blessing his name, to a call to know the character of God. His name represents who he is. And there's so many ways the Lord designates himself. We don't have time today to unfold all of them. But I think about the Jehovah designations. Jehovah Tsidkenu, my favorite. The Lord, our righteousness. Jehovah Rapha, the Lord, our healer. And on we could go with the designated names of God. Bless his name, which is called to know the character of God. We're told that we're to do all these things for the Lord is good. It is true that God is love, is one of the great designations that he has given to himself. It's also true that God is holy, is probably the greatest designation he's given himself. But in this case, the psalmist wants us to know, to remember that the Lord is good. Nothing passes through the hands or comes from the hands of a good God to us that is not good for us. Oh, how we need to remember that. Even the things we call bad, even the things we call tragic, traumatic, devastating. Some here faced devastating providences this past year. Some are on the cusp of facing them. And if we cannot see the goodness in the providence, then we remember the goodness of the God of the providence. He is good. His steadfast love, this term here, is his merciful covenant love. His covenant commitment to his people. He is loved with an everlasting love, and Jesus Christ was sent as the infallible proof of this covenant love, that he intends to keep his covenant. That as surely as he had Abram pass through those animals cut in two, as he passed through the animals cut in two, as Abram went into a deep sleep and observed this of God, that God pledged in that, I will be to you everything I promised to be to you. His steadfast love. It's not passing, it's not fickle, it's not up and down. His steadfast love endures forever. The song that we read, that every refrain is his mercy endures forever. Give thanks for this, his mercy endures forever. See, the Lord is good. He keeps his word. He saved you and me. And he has set his heart upon some yet that he will save. And he will not change his mind. And he will not lose his affection. And he hath lost it for you. And his faithfulness to all generations. That this God who is faithful to you and to me will be faithful to our children and our grandchildren. He does, the commandment teaches, he does visit the iniquity of the fathers upon the children of the third and fourth generation of those who hate him, but he shows covenant mercy to those who love him, to the thousands of generations. You see, this is our God. Know the character of your God. He's good today, no matter what's happening in this world. This good God is still in control, still has the whole world in his hands. The this good God is still on track, keeping his covenant love for us. This good God, even when we are faithless, even when our faith falters, he is faithful from generation to generation to generation. And we can sing without hesitance, "Great is your faithfulness, O God, our Father." And when we put the eyes of faith, when we look at life through the lenses of this good, covenant-keeping, faithful God, we can say, "Morning by morning, your mercies I see. All I've needed, your hands have provided. Great is your faithfulness, Lord, unto me." Two lessons I want to take away from this today. First of all, joy and gladness are marks of followers of Jesus Christ. And these marks should spill over in a desire to be with the people of God in the presence of God. Mark it down. When your desire for being with the people of God in the presence of God is waning, check the level of joy and gladness. Because to the extent that that level is rising, then these reflections of it. Secondly, a right knowledge of God is essential to a joyful and glad heart that will also provoke a desire to gather with the people of God in the house of God to worship him with thankful hearts. Coming to church is not the be-all, end-all. And someone said, coming to church doesn't make you a Christian any more than going into a garage makes you a car. But there's something about being a follower of Jesus, filled with thankfulness and joy at who he is and what he has done for poor sinners, and the longing to be with the people of God who share that experience. There's something about that that is as close to heaven as we will get on this earth. Worship God with a thankful heart. Not just the last week of November when we emphasize Thanksgiving, but spilling into December as we reflect upon the wonderful birth of our precious Savior, the great gift, the greatest gift. Spilling over into the new year, whatever it may be. Whatever faces in that year. As the months unfold one after another, that we don't see in the rearview mirror in the distance a time of worshiping God with thankful hearts, but rather it will be the lenses for us through which we see the present and the future. It's my desire for me as I serve you as your pastor, it's my desire for you as we serve one another and serve the Lord.